Hey, it's Dr. Kate Walker. I am coming to you live from Denton, Texas. So everybody in Denton, let me just wave to you. I hope you guys are having a great day. I am in Denton moving my middle child into her new apartment. So that never stops the Thursday 30. So what I'm doing right now is I get myself organized. I'm thinking about June is back to basics. We're all getting back to basics. You know, we have the pandemic, we have so many things, so much unrest, so much going on in our lives that is making, it's making our business change in ways that we weren't expecting. And it's important right now that we do look at our business structure, we get back to basics and we think about what's going on and how we want to maybe change our business, maybe do something a little bit differently. Hey, Solangel. Hey, Adriana, it's good to have you. I'm a little bit stuffy this morning. I think maybe our hotel room is got a little bit of mold. I don't know. I'm not complaining and I'm not gonna name names. I'm not gonna tell you where I'm staying. But let's talk about basics, because one of the things, back to basics, a lot of people ask me about LLCs, PLLCs, DBAs. Hey, Jennifer. Hey, Maureen. Thanks for watching. And so I wanted to start this off sort of deconstructing that. Now, oh, thank you, Darla. Yeah, I love my shirt too, because it really does represent how I feel right now. My daughter is possibly, my youngest may not graduate next week because there's a hurricane coming now, like a tropical depression or something. So we're looking at her graduation possibly getting rained out. So much happening. So when we look at how to form our company, I think it just gets so confusing. And I know I have a lot of interns that watch this. So if you guys want to go back and think about like visioning and vision boards and who am I, what am I, and what am I doing, that's back in November. And I will touch on it again. You can go to my YouTube channel, Kate Walker Training, and you can look back and see past Thursday 30s where I get more into sort of the visioning and trying to understand how you want your business to be. This month in June, I'm really gonna hit the nuts and bolts. LLCs, PLLCs, DBAs, S-Corp, C-Corp, what are we doing here, right? And what I've found is that going back to the basics, especially for those of you, and I do see some people on here who are seasoned practitioners, when you check out this video, you're gonna check it out because some things are changing. You're gonna find out that you don't have enough time, maybe you're worried about liability, you're paying too much in taxes, or not enough money is coming in. And that's usually the reason once a year I break my business down to the basics. I look to see what's working, what's not working. If you want to look back at January at the Thursday 30, I literally had a video called This Is What Was Working For Me in 2019. So I can imagine what this year is going to look like. It's really important that you are specific about what's working and what's not working. Hey, Marianne, thanks for watching. And David, thank you for watching too. You can't come in the hotel room right now because I'm filming. So just hang out in the lobby for a little while. So when you think about what's not working, it's also really important that you're not married to an idea. You have to be able to just get rid of anything. You know, if it's not working, we talked about last month, big pumpkins, little pumpkins, and we'll do that again, probably in July. We may even start a Facebook group or one of these rooms where we can really dig into the pumpkin plan. But again, this is about really starting off with the basic, what's working, what's not. So since I am not a lawyer and I don't play one on TV, I'm not an accountant and I don't play one on TV. So please don't take any of this as legal advice. If you do, bad on you, because I have not been educated in that way. So when I talk about these things, please be sure that you double check me with your trusted attorney, legal counsel, or friend who knows more than I do, okay? Hey, Cheryl, thanks for watching. So LLC, what does it do? LLC stands for Limited Liability Corporation. Liability is the key word here. A limited liability corporation is going to create your business. It's going to create a status for your business that is different than just opening up a lemonade stand on the street, right? If I open up a lemonade stand and I sell Mrs. Jones down the street some lemonade that gives her a tummy ache and she decides to sue me, well, basically, she could sue me for everything. my car, my house, any land that I own, any assets that I have. So with a limited liability corporation, the LLC status, it gives some separation. I like to think of it like a virtual wall. So you have a wall between your lemonade stand and your house, car, and your personal assets. So Mrs. Jones can still sue me, but if my lemonade stand is Kate's Lemonade Stand LLC, then she will, in theory, only get the contents of my lemonade stand, which is a couple of cardboard boxes and a pitcher that I stole out of my mom's cupboard. So when she finishes her lawsuit, she may try to get more. And again, not a lawyer, so there may be other ways that she can try to get my assets. But if I have formed that LLC, thanks Brandy, then in theory, my assets are protected. So let's take that idea, because liability is a great way to sort of tear down our business to the nuts and bolts and see, okay, what do we need to start with? Always start with the liability, okay? Hey, Cree, thanks for joining. So with the PLLC, P stands for Professional LLC, Professional LLC. Hey, Jules, thanks for watching. And I did a little research on this because when I started my business in 2004, all about the family LLC, I was doing what I'm doing now. I was providing professional services that required a license, and I was doing some training and teaching. And so my accountant and I decided together that I would form an LLC rather than a PLLC. Now, when I did my little research here, what I noticed was Texas is a state where you may have a PLLC. Now, that may language is really important to me, especially after the rule changes in 2019, because what we found was that may is not as assertive as must or shall. So when I look at the law, what I see is there in Texas, you have permission to have a PLLC, and there are extra regulations. And so not everybody can get a PLLC. It must be only for businesses that require a license. So doctor, lawyer, architect, LPC, LMFT, we get to have a PLLC. Now, I hope you guys post in the thread if you know more about this than I do, because I don't really see the advantage. As I'm reading, it looks like the PLLC takes longer. There are a few more hoops you must jump through. And to me, it seems limiting. You guys know, if you watch me, if you have been on any of these Thursday 30s, you know I am a big fan of multiple streams of income and lots of baskets for your chicken eggs, right? We don't want to put everything into one basket. And so when I say that I'm a PLLC, I don't think that prohibits me from doing training or any other side hustle that I want to do, but it does feel, it from a marketing perspective, that I'm a little bit pigeonholed. So I would love it if somebody would help me and get some more information on that and post it in the thread, because I don't really see the advantage of having a PLLC. Hey, Suzanne, thanks for watching, but I could be wrong. So it comes down to liability. PLLC, LLC, these are all limited liability corporation status, right? It's a status for you, your business, your lemonade stand. So if Mrs. Jones gets a tummy ache from your lemonade, she can sue you all she wants, but all she's gonna get are your cardboard boxes and some lemon rinds. Now, one of the things I did read for a PLLC, and we'll talk about this in a second, is it can protect you from things that your employees do, right? So if you have other people working with you, if you decide to have a big practice, perhaps you're doing some supervision, it can add some additional support, right? Hey, Ruby, thanks for watching. And so again, you're gonna have to investigate that on your own, because we have an additional level of protection, and that's our malpractice insurance. I know mine is coming due here in another month, and I'm actually changing companies. I had the same company, my goodness, for 12, 15 years, and I'm changing now because I need additional protection because of the supervision and the training that I do. Hey, Julietta, thanks for watching. And so, as I start to think about levels of protection, I've got my LLC, and then I took an additional step. So those of you who have side hustles, you might want to think about this as well. As you're deconstructing your business, if you find that you're doing side hustles that provide you with any significant amount of income, you might want to create two LLCs, right? So two distinct corporations. So the actions of one corporation don't affect the actions in another one, right? So if I had a lemon grove and I grew lemons and I wanted to sell my lemons, I might want to create Kate's Lemon Groves LLC, which is different from Kate's Lemonade Stand LLC. So when Mrs. Jones sues me because she gets a tummy ache, she's not going to get my lemon trees, right? She's going to get the cardboard boxes and my mom's old pitcher. So we have different ways of structuring things, and visually, I'm a visual person, so I think of them as virtual fences or virtual walls between the actions of my business and my cozy home, my assets, my car, my millions of dollars in land, my lot, my yacht, and my Bentley. Just kidding, I don't have any of those. I'm not gonna tell you where I'm staying. So you see that it's really, really important as we get back to basics that we start with liability. Okay, and just let me take a second here while I'm saying the word basic again and again, and I've got all 14 of you on here. I am offering a special this month on my Badass Business Builders course. It's regularly $250. If you type in the word basic, B-A-S-I-C, when you're checking out, you get 50% off the course. The course includes a 30-minute consultation with me, and we're getting some mastermind groups together as well from this course. It's a great course. It's just a way to really break down your objectives, backwards plan the crap out of them, make sure that you've got the support you need to achieve what you want to achieve in your business. So basic, go to Kate Walker Training, purchase the Badass Business Builders DIY course, enter basic when you're checking out, get the discount. All right, so liability. It brings up this idea, and I'm just gonna make a little bitty aside here. DBA, doing business as. It's literally the letters D as in David, B as in boy, A, DBA. And so it does nothing for you, okay? DBA simply allows you to go to the bank and open up a banking account with that name on it. So your checks, when you get your checkbook, it's got your business name on it instead of your name. Hey, Jenny, and thanks for watching. And so DBA offers no protection. It basically, in most counties, will give you 10 years of ownership for your business name. That's all. It's almost like old, you know, good old days. Back in the day, this is what we did before we bought domain names, right? So when you go to GoDaddy and you look up your name that you want to have for your practice, it's kind of the same thing. Except with GoDaddy, you have to pay yearly, or sometimes they'll let you do every 2 years. I know for me, I've got, if you watch this, you know I love Trello. So every year I have a reminder that pops up that says, check and make sure that you still own your domain names, right? Because that's where my money is. That's where my business lives. And if somebody were to sneak in and purchase my domain name out from under me, that would be catastrophic. So every 10 years, weirdly enough, I have a reminder that goes off that reminds me every 10 years that my business names will expire at the county level. Now, keep in mind, I still have an LLC that's filed with the state. I still have taxes that I file under my LLC, but I'm trying to help you understand the difference between LLC, PLLC, and then this rogue DBA. Remember, DBA does nothing. It just allows you to do business as. So I'm Kate Walker, but I do business as Achieve Balance. I'm Kate Walker, but I do business as Kate Walker Training LLC. And so that's just, you know, you've seen the little DBAs on people's stuff. That's what that's for. A little bit added tax information. There are some designations that are more advantageous to you, and they'll be called an S corp or a C corp, and your accountant can help you more with this. But once you decide to get an LLC, you're going to want to decide if you want to have this corporate tax, which we don't want that. We don't want double tax. We don't want to get taxed on our profit. and on our corporation. That is not good, right? So that's a C corp. We don't. I'm not an accountant. Just saying, you may not want that one. So S corp is a pass-through designation. It basically means you're a disregarded entity, and so you don't get double taxed. Please double check me. But that's what you're looking at. For those of you who are brand new, and I know we got tons of interns, I want you to make sure you have good information. This video is a great place to start. You guys see me going online, and I'm gonna do some searching here. You need to make sure that you double check with your accountant, but that's where we start. And while I'm at it, I need to welcome our new members. We've got CNA Krauk, Lisa Lott, Molly O'Cherry Cunningham, Amanda Franklin, Monique Rack. I'm so glad you're here. Monique helped me out at TCA and she ran my booth. She's awesome. And Dana Martinez and Tara Eason Warner. I'm so glad you guys are here getting your businesses up to badass. Now, let's talk about the size of your business, because as I mentioned before, the PLLC can give you, the owner, some additional protection if you have people working underneath you. Now let's define underneath you, because TWC is getting involved with this and making it a little bit more complicated. Hey, Julie, thanks. That's awesome. Awesome thought there. I agree with you. And so when you have the people working under you, that could be supervision as well. Remember, this discussion today really isn't going to be about 1099 versus W-2 employees and things of that nature. I will happily do a Thursday 30 on that. But as you're thinking about getting started, solo practice versus big practice, if you ask around in this group, I think you're going to find that most of us start off slowly. Most of us start as a single practice because it does limit liability, right? The bigger you get, and I hope some of the large practice owners in this group chime in on this, the bigger you get, the more liability there is if someone's not only practicing next door to you, but maybe they're practicing and supervising, right? Because remember, when you're supervising, all of your interns' clients are your clients. So your client load, the possibility for mistakes, grows exponentially. And it's doable. And I don't want to discourage anybody from doing that. But as we're starting off with the basics and we're breaking this down to what works and a really solid foundation, starting off making sure that you have the correct designation for your business, maybe operating by yourself for a while, just making sure you know the ropes. You know, I believe anything new that I start is going to take me at least a year to learn, right? So if I start a new side hustle or if I added another person to my practice, it's gonna take me at least a year to learn how to do that. That's a year of invoicing, a year of collecting money to pay my taxes, a year of marketing, making mistakes, correcting mistakes. So go slow, allow yourself to start learning this thing. And that's one of the great things about choosing a course, whether it's mine or somebody else's, or you get a business coach, somebody to help you along the way. They help say, hey, calm down, it's okay, it's normal, it's okay to make this mistake. I always like to talk about my favorite mistake, one of my favorite mistakes. I had a DVD set where I wrote about all five of my favorite mistakes, but my almost ultimate favorite mistake was, you know, I just didn't put any money aside for taxes. How about that? So, you know, April rolled around, I had a pretty good year. My tax accountant says, you know what, that's super, you only owe $10,000. And I'm like, what? I don't have $10,000. Where's that supposed to come from, Mr. Taxman? So yeah, lesson learned. And so now I pay quarterly taxes. So as we're looking at this and we're thinking about how many people do you want to have, a big practice or a small practice, you might also start looking at your business plan. And I'm getting sort of to the end of my time here, and this is probably where I will lead off for next time. But the business plan is something that it's kind of like a treatment plan. It communicates to someone else, you know, banks especially, right, how you anticipate making money. And so with counseling, we have one of the lowest overheads on the planet, right? We're not out buying x-ray machines. We're not out buying, you know, tons of equipment and hiring, you know, lots of personnel just to make our stuff go. We're actually in a business where we can start with an old couch and a used computer and rented office space. So it's still, that still doesn't mean we get to skip the business planning part. Hey, Diane, thanks for watching. Elsa, glad you're here. So when you start the business planning part, it goes back to what I talked about a few Thursday 30s ago, which is your break-even analysis. Your break-even analysis is consisting of month by month, what's going out and what's coming in. So this is going to tell you, ready, drum roll please, how many hours do you need to work each week? How many hours do you want to work each week? And so think of that as rooms in a hotel, right? Kind of like where I am right now. You want to make sure if you're having, you know, if you're setting aside 6 hours a day as business hours, you want 6 hours of working time? Do you want 3 hours of working time and 3 hours of paperwork time? Then once you decide that, you can do the math and decide what you want to charge per hour. And that, here we go, this is gonna help you decide if you want to be on insurance panels or if you want to try to get a cash basis. You know, when I say cash, let me put that in air quotes, right? Cash credit card. It just means that you're not going to file insurance for your clients. Now, this isn't such a bad model, either one. They're both wonderful, taking insurance or not taking insurance. And there are lots of great business plans out there. And again, I think this might be a topic for a Facebook room. I'm so excited about this Facebook room idea because I think we could have a business planning room. We could have a marketing room. We could have a break-even analysis room and really drill down into the stuff that's foundational. Because if you start with your business and you're working 40 hours a week and you don't plan on working any less, and then your life situation changes, right? Someone gets sick, someone gets married, somebody has a baby. You're going to be then out of balance. And as counselors, we don't have that option. Folks, we can't allow ourselves to get burned out. And we're noticing that now, right? With the COVID pandemic, and the deaths that are happening, and Black Lives Matter, and the protests, we're getting traumatized vicariously, right? Or directly, right? We're marching or we're watching the marches. We're looking at the comments that people are putting in these threads. We're feeling this, and then we're trying to go be there emotionally for our clients. If you have set up a business plan where you don't have time to take a breath and take care of you, go to your own therapy, take care of what you need to take care of, you're not gonna be able to be there for your clients. You know what the t-shirt says, you are too important to lose to things like breaking rules, going broke, giving up, burning out, right? Hashtag counselors don't quit. And so this group is for you, this whole entire Facebook group is for you. If you're a supervisor, I need you when this is over to run over virtually and click on Texas Supervisor Training. We have our lineup ready. I've already got 5 people booked for next year and they're amazing. They're gonna talk to us about the laws. I've got an LPC board member who's going to be talking with us. $25, $25 for one consultation, group consultation, right? So it's 2 hours, 2 CEs. Hey, Linda, thanks for watching. So when this is done, go over to Texas Supervisor Training. What am I gonna talk about next time? Put it in the thread. Tell me what you want me to talk about next time. My plan is to talk about money. Remember I told you with the basics, you're either breaking your business down. If you are one of the old hands like me and you've been in practice for a while, you're here because you don't have enough time, you're worried about liability, you're paying too much in taxes, or you don't have enough money coming in. If you're an intern and you're brand new, all of this stuff sounds like alphabet soup, right? But we start with liability, we design the business. So next time I'd like to talk about the business plan. You tell me if you want me to do something different. Then we'll talk about money, then we'll talk about marketing, right? So in June, this is getting back to the basics. Remember, if you go to Kate Walker Training and you purchase the Badass Business Course and enter the word basic, B-A-S-I-C, when you're checking out, you will get a 55% discount. All right, guys, post your questions and comments in the thread. Have a great week. I am so sorry 2020 sucks, but it's gonna get better because we're gonna make it that way. All right, have a great week.